I presume by now you would be saying that, Vineet, it is too hard to believe that this works. And I'm not saying that it works. Let me share with you some experiments we did at HCL. Let me share with you how we did it. Let me share with you the results of those experiments. But upfront, let me share with you that I believe they are experiments. They are small catalyst actions. Some of them we have got right. A lot of them we have got wrong. But the very fact that only a few we got right have created a huge value for HCL. The reason I'm talking to you is I believe we are only 10% done and 90% still needs to be discovered. And I'm hoping through this communication I will be able to reach out to many, many bright minds out there who would learn from what HCL has done, but also contribute to the thinking within HCL. And I'm very happy for HCL to be the base for experiments, for your ideas, because we are looking for new ideas where we can continue our experiments going forward. At HCL, we came up with a philosophy 5 years ago called employees first, customers second. Yes, employees first, customers second. And the philosophy logic is the same as I explained, that the employees are in the value zone. They are the people who are creating the true value for our customers. By management holding itself accountable to the employees, we actually create higher value for our customers compared to organizations where the CEO is playing golf with the other CEO. That resulted into our articulation with our customers, actually, that employees come first for the management and the organization, and customers come second. By that, we mean that if we follow this philosophy, the customers will automatically come first. Now, before I talk about what did we do, let me just talk about the results. We are the fastest growing IT services company. We are based in India. We, in recession, grew 21% year on year, which is calendar year 2009 over 2008, when everybody was actually degrowing and demonstrating negative growth, both in revenues and income. Our customer satisfaction went up by 43% during the recession. We were declared number one in employee satisfaction across various surveys in various countries. Business Week talks to us about the 5 most emerging companies to watch out for, and our management style of employees first, customer second is taught across the world. Those are the results. But how did we get there? And what are the experiments which you potentially could learn from? Remember, I talked about a catalyst actions. And I think the first catalyst action is a story of an ant. An ant is an ant is an ant. It can be a fast-walking ant, a rich ant, an ant with a Mercedes, or a flying ant, but ant is an ant. It is very important for organizations as a starting step to want to be a butterfly. If you want to be a butterfly, not only you have to will to be a butterfly, but you have to stop being an ant. And therefore, the first catalyst thought for you to think about is that there is no half-baked measures. So when you execute any of the catalysts which I talked about, you need to try and create conviction amongst yourself that, yes, that's what I want to do, and take it to the extreme. If we don't push the envelope and take it to the extreme and do half-baked action, I don't think transformation will happen. So when you decide you want to be a butterfly, stop being an ant. That's my first catalyst advice. The second is, you know, the most difficult part of the transformation is how do you make the reverse accountability happen. And I think there is an understanding there are power centers and value centers. If you understand power centers, these power centers are largely around enabling functions. HR, finance, administration, not that they want to be, but because the controls are so important that they create power centers in those organizations. And to get anything done in the organization from this power center is a very long exercise. So our catalyst action in HCL was to create what we call a smart service desk, a trouble ticketing system where any employee can open any trouble ticket on any of the enabling functions, or actually even me as a CEO, and there is a limited time which we have to close the ticket, and it's the employee who actually closes the ticket. That's a small catalyst action which inverted the pyramid of the power centers, and suddenly the power centers became what I call service centers. Let's talk about the managers, as I call it, the hand of God. What do you mean by hand of God? The hand of God is because the manager has all the financial information, because the manager has this powerful phone call he can make to the enabling function to make the magic happen for you, because the manager has so much power in his hand, he's the hand of God which will help you move up your career. And that's the accepted norm within a lot of organizations, unfortunately true. So how do you destroy that? You destroy that by first making the information available at every desktop. So you destroy what I call the information power center. My huge amount of automation, so financial information, data, is honestly exhibited in the organization, and communication channels are open. It is transparent and it is open. The second thing you do is, for making the management as accountable to the employees, we experimented with the 360-degree tool. And I say this experiment because this experiment is only a 5-year-old experiment, and I think we need to do a lot more to declare success. We said that instead of discovering leaders, leaders should emerge. And the way the leaders could emerge is by their influence on the influence zone, which is the employees. So if we ask the employees to do the 360-degree of the managers, we find the employees are not interested in doing it, because what is in it for me? So we said, what happens if the managers are asked to show the results of the 360-degree survey to the employees who gave the survey? Suddenly we make the connection, we make the collaboration happen. So I started this exercise in 2005. For the first time in 2005, there were 30,000 employees in HCL. Today we are 57,000 employees. I made my 360-degree available to all employees, the people who gave me feedback and the people who did not give me feedback. And I said that that feedback is so important for me that it will bring about a change in the way I manage, because that is my constituency, that is the place I want to create a value. When the managers saw me doing it, they gained trust in saying that, hey, why don't we do it? Because that's a great way of communicating with my employees and getting their feedback. So more and more people do it. Today in HCL, there are 3,500 managers who participate in the 360-degree survey, and they share the results with all the employees who gave them feedback. What does that mean? That means two things. First, as a CEO and as a manager, when you're sharing your 360-degree, you've started the process of reverse accountability. Once the feedback comes and it is out in the open, you clearly know who are the managers and who are not the managers, who are supposed to be good in individual contributors like the technical functions. Now, because the result is public, you do not use it for evaluation. You use it only for development purposes, and the leaders will automatically move towards higher management role or higher individual contributor role, depending on the feedback they're getting. I do not believe in HCL we could have found any other way of inverting this pyramid so effectively, discover emerging leaders and getting the leaders automatically to graduate towards their area of strength. That is another catalyst we used, which is very effective. Let's talk about how do we transition the catalyst and experiments we did of handing over the change of control to the employees and giving the charge to them to bring about a change. I think the first important experiment which I did, and I don't know whether you want to do that or not, was to demolish the concept of this corner office. So I went, actually, this was in 2006, I went in front of all our employees in groups of 4,000, 5,000, and danced in front of them. Now, I can tell you that I can't dance for nuts. The reason I did that is there is so much gap, perception gap, that there is so much halo around the CEO that you really cannot have a decent conversation with the CEO. And that is true with the manager. So don't say that this is a CEO conversation and it is not relevant to you as a manager. There is so much halo around even a manager that the employee doesn't have a decent conversation with you. And to level the field, you can dance, you can do whatever it is, but it is important that before you have a conversation, you level the field. And that's one of the catalysts which I used. The second catalyst I use, if very effectively, is what I call the you and I conversation, where not only I have a conversation with the employees on an open blog, it is open that anybody who's asking the question, his name is shown to all the employees, and when I answer the question, that is also shown to all the employees. Not one question is positive on the blog. Every single question is negative, and if you read it, you will believe that HCL is in a mess. But the very fact that we washed the dirty linen in public, gives so much confidence to the employees that this company means business, the CEO is, and the management of the company is standing accountable, and there is a reverse accountability automatically sets in. There are many, many such other catalysts we have employed in HCL, and as I said, some have worked. But I think this experimentation journey in employees first, customer second has to continue. I don't think we have all the answers. I don't think we have even all the questions. And I'm looking forward through this mixed channel, an ability to be able to tap into your bright thinking, your bright ideas to help me transform HCL, to make it faster, grow better, for the employees to feel happy, for all of us to be able to create value, which we so need in the world today.